At the end of the 1800s, public leaders began to realize that land in the United States was being damaged by poor land policies. This realization led to public efforts to conserve soils, efforts that continue today. To preserve land, one first needs to study it, and that study needs a system for describing, naming, and classifying soil. With these tools, soil professionals can survey the land and describe what they find. A start was made in the early 1900s when the government began to survey and classify the U.S. soils. I'm Dr. DeBusk, and in this video, I will briefly review some history of soil classification, describe the current system, and then discuss soil surveys. Soil survey depends on a system of grouping soils of like properties. Soil classification helps us understand, remember, and communicate knowledge about soils. The USDA introduced the first classification system in 1960. The system of soil taxonomy is based on properties of the soil as it can be observed in the field or laboratory. While the USDA's soil taxonomy can be universally applied to the soils of the globe, outside the United States, many nations employ their own systems to serve their own purposes. It resembles the way plants and animals are grouped. As shown in the figure, the system has six levels of classification. The highest rank, the soil order, is the broadest group. The system recognizes 12 soil orders, based mainly on presence or absence of certain key layers in the soil profile, as well as on average temperatures and rainfall. An example of a soil order is an entisol, a soil showing few signs of soil and horizon development. The name for all soil orders ends with the suffix sol. Soils are further divided into suborder, great group, subgroup, and family. Those who use soils at the local level, such as growers, builders, or county extension agents, are more concerned about the lowest soil grouping called the soil series. The soil series is the taxonomic group with the narrowest range of features, and all pedons within a series have very similar soil profiles. Each series is given the name of the town, county, or other location near where the series was first identified. Miaca, a typical flatwood soil, is the Florida state soil. Miaca soils contain mostly sand and is a deep, somewhat poorly drained acid soil. Miaca is in the order Spodosol, which you will learn about in the next few slides. As described earlier, soil scientists currently divide soils into 12 soil orders. While each of these orders carries a technical formal definition, here we will provide a simple description of each. The orders bolded can be found in Florida. Alphasols usually are soils of deciduous forests of temperate, moist climates. The A horizon is typically light-colored, and in undisturbed soils, O horizons often occur at the surface. Surface horizons may be acidic. Alphasols are generally good agricultural soils and constitute about 13% of U.S. soils, especially in north-central states. Andisols form in geologically recent volcanic materials. The parent materials are weathered particles of volcanic glass, which provide a very distinctive soil. Ando means black. The soil is lightweight, typically dark-colored, high in organic matter, easy to till, with a high water-holding capacity. These also make good agricultural soils and make up about 2% of U.S. soils, mostly in the Pacific Northwest, Hawaii, and Alaska. Aridisols are soils of arid climates of cool to hot deserts and shrublands, often with alkaline and salted horizons. Arid means dry. Aridisols are not productive for agriculture unless irrigated, as many are in western United States. Entisols lack well-developed horizons. Int means recent. They may be young or form under conditions that inhibit soil development, such as climatic extremes or resistant parent material. Entisols are the least developed of the soil orders, so they don't have much in the way of noticeable horizons. They are extremely variable, scattered throughout the country, and sometimes difficult to use. Gelisols are very cold soils of the tundra, cold desert, or high peaks. Gel means cold. There's permafrost in the subsoil. Often the surface is peat because the cold, wet conditions inhibit decay. There may be evidence of soil disturbance from freeze-thaw cycles. Gelisols are also a very large carbon sink. In the United States, they are found mostly in Alaska. Histosols form under decaying organic matter in wetlands. Hist means organic. The lack of oxygen slows decay, so organic materials accumulate, reaching contents greater than 20 to 30%. These materials are often called peats and mucks. Histosols can be drained for growing certain crops, but suffer from subsidence or even fire. Like gelosols, histosols function as large carbon sinks. Inceptosols are another young soil, but slightly better developed than entosols. Incept means inception. Mollosols are rich, dark soils of the grassland. Moll means soft. There must be a deep, dark A horizon with high base saturation. They typically form under conditions of moderate to low rainfall. Mollosols are considered the richest of agricultural soils, but lack of rainfall may be limiting for agriculture. Mollosols comprise of 25% of U.S. soils, mostly of the Plain States and some areas of the Pacific Northwest, but extending through Iowa into Illinois. Oxisols are highly weathered soils of the tropics. Ox means oxide. The A horizon is low in organic matter, and the soil is largely comprised of granules of iron oxide clays that behave like sand. Oxisols are often red to yellow in color because of iron oxides. Spodosols most often form under coniferous forest conditions in cool, moist regions, but also found in Florida. Spode means wood ash. They are light-colored, acidic, coarse soils, often lacking in an A horizon, but usually with an E. Spodosols make very poor agricultural soils, useful for acid-loving plants such as potatoes, blueberries, or forests. About 5% of U.S. soils are spodosols, mostly in the northern tier of the Midwestern and Northeastern states. Oltosols are highly weathered soils of warm, humid climates, but not as weathered as oxisols. It can be quite acidic, inhibiting plant growth. The subsoil is often reddish in color. Oltosols are not naturally fertile soils, but are used for agriculture with proper fertilization and liming. About 13% of U.S. soils are oltosols, found mostly in the southeast. Verdosols form from parent materials very high in clays that shrink and swell during drying and wetting cycles, such that large soil cracks form. This causes a churning of the soil that mixes the upper soil. They are said to be self-inverting. Vert means turn. Verdosols make up about 1% of U.S. soils, most commonly in south-central states. In this figure, you can see that several soil orders make up Florida. Some are widespread, like spodosols, inosols, and oltosols, while others are localized, like histosols. Still others are found in pockets, like inceptosols and mollosols. The USDA developed the soil classification system for use in soil surveys. Soil surveys classify, locate on a base map, and describe soils as they appear in the field. Soil surveys tell what soils are in a given location, what the properties of those soils are, and how they can be used. Soil surveys are performed under the auspices of the National Cooperative Soil Survey Program, a joint effort of the USDA Natural Resources Conservation Service, or NRCS, and state agricultural experiment stations. Most of the actual surveying is done by NRCS soil scientists. Mapping a soil typically begins with a preliminary study of older soil surveys, if they exist, and documents such as aerial photographs. The survey then moves out into the field. This soil scientist, conducting a soil survey in Virginia, observes surface features, probes the soil, and records field observations on a small handheld computer for geographic processing. Notice the GPS unit on her back. Different mapping units are used in soil surveys, depending on how large an area the map or survey covers. For small areas, mapping units are detailed phases of soil series. For larger scaled maps, the units may be higher levels of the soil taxonomy, like families or great groups. For most county maps, phases of soil series are the basic mapping unit. Soil survey maps are drawn to scale appropriate to the area and detail needed. The larger the scale, the larger the area covered, but the less detailed offered. Most county surveys are drawn to scales of 1 to 12,000 or 1 to 31,680. GPSs, GISs, and remote sensing are technological tools available to today's soil surveyors. GPS relies on 24 satellites in orbit about the Earth, positioned such that any point on the Earth's surface receives a signal from at least four satellites. Remote sensing gathers information about a site from a distance by using sensors mounted on planes or satellites. GISs are powerful computer software programs that organize and integrate data from a variety of sources, such as soil data from GPS points, remote sensing data, and all sorts of other relevant data, such as zoning information or watershed boundaries. GIS software can then integrate all the data and generate a variety of reports and maps. A completed soil map becomes part of a soil survey report, typically for a county. A soil survey report has four major parts: a set of soil maps, map legends that explain the map symbols, descriptions of the soils, and use and management reports for each soil. All these parts provide much useful information about the soil, including taxonomy, description of the soil, and soil properties for each horizon. It provides suitability for urban landscapes such as turf, ornamentals, and gardening, as well as rating of suitability for engineering projects such as landfills, buildings, and roads, for water management projects such as reservoirs, drainage, and irrigation, and for recreational development such as playgrounds and campgrounds. It provides the potential for cropping, including capability class and woodland and wildlife suitability. Soil maps are the heart of good land use planning. Soil maps get the information needed to make good land use decisions, whether the decision maker is a national planner or a farmer, home builder, or landscape designer. Soil surveys and maps provide the basis for placing soils into a variety of capability and limitation classes. These are systems for classifying soils according to their suitability for various uses, such as agriculture, forests, drain fields, landscaping, or others. Best known as the USDA's Land Capability Class System, which primarily rates soils according to their suitability for agriculture and also for pasture, rangeland, timber, recreation, and other uses. The system indicates the best long-term use of land to protect it from erosion or other problems. The NRCS recognizes 8 land capability classes. Class 1 soils have the fewest limitations, and Class 8 soils are so limited as to be totally unsuitable for agriculture. Erosion hazard due to slope is the main criterion, but other criteria are used as well. A single slash in the table indicates that very careful management is needed and that the soil cannot be safely used for this purpose every year. This vineyard in California exemplifies Class 1 land, level land free of hazard of erosion and suitability for all uses. While vineyards are generally clean cultivated, as is this one, leaving soil bare is damaging to soil quality. This vineyard is drip irrigated. All classes except Class 1 have one or more limitations. Land capability subclasses indicate factors that limit soil use by means of a single letter code added to the class number. A Class 2E soil, for instance, is slightly limited by erosion hazards. A Class 6E soil is very limited by erosion hazards. The letter codes are as follows: E, runoff and erosion. Lands with slopes greater than 2% are those that need some form of erosion control. W, wetness. These soils may be poorly drained or occasionally flooded. Some such soils may be drained, others are classified as wetlands and are best left as is. S, root zone or tillage problems. These soils are shallow, stony, droughty, infertile, or saline. Wind and water erosion may be problems. C, climatic hazard. Areas of rainfall or temperature extremes make farming difficult. Examples include deserts or the far north. Besides the USDA capability classes, soils can also be classified by their limitations for any use, perhaps for landscaping or tree nurseries or residential streets. In these schemes, soil carries limitations for a given application rated as slight, moderate, or severe. These ratings are based on criteria relevant to that use. Land with slight limitation is favorable for a particular use without modification. Land with moderate limitations has mild problems that can be overcome with reasonable modification and prior planning. Land with severe limitations is unfavorable for the proposed use. For instance, high shrink swell potential, low soil strength, and severe frost action all present severe limitations for road construction. The USDA offers formal criteria for a number of uses, and the information needed to categorize the soil can be found in tables and county soil survey reports. Land users can readily transfer the results of soil ratings for an area onto a soil map to graphically reveal land suitable or unsuitable for various purposes. We might call these land use or interpretive maps. On the soil map, mapping units are colored in, often with green, go, for areas with slight limitations, yellow, caution, for those with moderate problems, and red, stop, for unfavorable soils. The United States is fortunate to have a great deal of good farmland. The figure summarizes the capability of non-federal U.S. soil, excluding Alaska. Approximately 43% of our soil is rated as Class 1 to 3. This is soil on which nearly any crop can be grown. Most of the rest of the U.S. land is suitable for some form of commercial production, such as grazing or woodlands. Good farmland is not evenly distributed over the United States. Corn Belt states have the highest percentage of good farmland, followed by Northern Plain states and Delta states. Much of the land of the West is too mountainous to be useful for cultivated crops. According to a definition used by The Economist in its 2007 World in Figures, 19% of the total land of the United States is arable, compared to about 11% of the world. By comparison, other selected countries include Saudi Arabia at 1% arable, Canada 5%, Mexico 13%, and Ukraine, a former territory of the USSR and its breadbasket, 56%. In conclusion, soil scientists presently classify soils according to their soil properties, profiles, and climate. Soil scientists survey land and prepare a soil map based on its classification system. Soils can also be classified as to their suitability for other uses, and conventional soil maps may be colored to represent the suitability of each mapping unit.